General Dempsey, you in one of your criteria for determining what we might do militarily, you say you have to ask the question whether the action is worth the cost and is consistent with law. What law does the United States military look to?
Yeah, if I could, since I'd like to address both because they are related. So cost, resources, risk incurred elsewhere by the use of force one other place. So, you know, it's a zero-sum game. We take them from someplace else, we use them for how long, and that's the kind of issue of cost. Is it, and of course, in blood and treasure. The issue of legal basis is important, though. You know, we act with the authorized use of military force either at the consent of a government, so we're invited in, or out of national self-defense, there's a very clear criteria for that. And then the last one is with some kind of international legal basis, an UNSCR.
Wait a minute. Let's talk about an international legal basis. You answer under the Constitution to the United States government, do you not? And you don't need any international support before you would carry out a military operation authorized by the commander.
No, of course not. That's the second. That's the second one.
I just want to know that because there's a lot of references in here to international matters before we make a decision, and I want to be sure that the United States military understands, and I know you do, that we're not dependent on a NATO resolution or a UN resolution to execute policies consistent with the national security of the United States. Now, Secretary Panella, you, in your talk, in your remarks, you talk about first we're working to increase diplomatic isolation and encouraging other countries to join the European Union and Arab League in imposing sanctions. And then you note that China and Russia have repeatedly blocked the UN Security Council from taking action. Are you saying, and is the president taking the position, he would not act if it was in our interest to do so if the UN Security Council did not agree?
When it comes to the kind of military action where we want to build a coalition and work with our international partners, then obviously we would like to have some kind of legal basis on which to do it as we did in Libya.
Now, some sort of legal basis. We worried about international legal basis, but nobody worried about the fundamental constitutional legal basis that this Congress has over war. We were not asked, stunningly, in direct violation of the War Powers Act, whether or not you believe it's constitution, it certainly didn't comply with it. We spent our time worrying about the UN, the Arab League, NATO, and too little time, in my opinion, worrying about the elected representatives of the United States. Do you think that you can act without Congress to initiate a no-fly zone in Syria without congressional approval?
You know, again, our goal would be to seek international permission, and we would come to the Congress and inform you and determine how best to approach this, whether or not we would want to get permission from the Congress. I think those are issues we would have to discuss as we decide what to do here.
Well, I'm almost breathless about that, because what I heard you say is we're going to seek international approval, and they will come and tell the Congress what we might do, and we might seek congressional approval.
No, well,
I want to just say to you, that's a big dish. Wouldn't you agree, you've served in the Congress,
yeah.
Wouldn't you agree that that's would be pretty breathtaking to the average American? So would you like to clarify that?
But I've also served with Republican presidents and Democratic presidents who have always reserved the right to defend this country if necessary.
But you, before we do this, you would seek permission of the international authorities.
If we're working with an international coalition and we're working with NATO, we would want to be able to get appropriate permissions in order to be able to do that. That's something that you know, all of these countries would want to have some kind of legal basis on which to act.
What legal basis are you looking for? What entity?
Well, obviously, if NATO made the decision to go in, that would be one. If we developed an international coalition beyond NATO, then obviously some kind of UN security resolution would be the basis for that.
So a coalition of, so you're saying NATO would give you a legal basis and an ad hoc coalition of nations would provide a legal basis?
If we were able to put together a coalition and were able to move together, then obviously we would seek whatever legal basis we would need in order to make that justified. I mean, you know, we can't just pull them all together in a combat operation without getting the legal basis on which to act.
Who are you asking for the legal basis from?
If it's obviously, if the UN passed a security resolution as it did in Libya, we would do that. If NATO came together as we did in Bosnia, we would rely on that. So, you know, we have options here if we want to build the kind of international approach to dealing with the situation.
Well, I'm for all for having an international support, but I'm really baffled by the idea that somehow an international assembly provides a legal basis for the United States military to be deployed in combat. I don't believe it's close to being correct. They can provide no legal authority. The only legal authority that's required to deploy the United States military is the Congress and the President and the law and the Constitution.
Let me just for the record be clear again, Senator, so there's no misunderstanding. When it comes to the national defense of this country, the President of the United States has the authority under the Constitution to act to defend this country, and we will. If it comes to an operation where we're trying to build a coalition of nations to work together to go in and operate as we did in Libya or Bosnia, for that matter, Afghanistan, we want to do it with permissions either by NATO or by the international community.